Elvis of wrestling. There ain't no bigger, there ain't no badder. He is the man.
He's a comic book hero come to life. At 6'7" and 300 pounds, he's wrestling's dominant symbol of the triumph of good over evil.
We're teaching a lesson, you know, the good guys win, and if you cheat and take shortcuts, you lose. Such is life.
He turned wrestling into a celebrity showcase that's now a multi-billion dollar industry.
Hulk really kind of put wrestling on the map and made people watch it and come out of the closet to see it.
Hulk Hogan has never been far from controversy. He made a sudden switch from hero to bad guy that infuriated fans. And he was forced to make admissions about steroids in a court case that threatened to end his career. For two decades, he's been in the spotlight as both a wrestler and actor. But there's a Hulk Hogan the public seldom sees. Friends say he's a dedicated family man who spends countless hours helping children's charities, and that he's a savvy businessman who calculates every move he makes.
This guy's not some big dumb wrestler. This guy has a lot of brains. He's a heck of a businessman. This is not an accident.
The Little Hulkster was born Terry Jean Bollea in August 1953 in Augusta, Georgia. Right from the start, Terry was a big boy.
He weighed 10'7" when he was born. I say a star was born that day. And we were awfully proud of him, even from a little fella.
Terry was the youngest of three brothers, and soon after he was born, the family moved to Tampa, Florida. From the time he started school, Terry literally stood out.
Kids in first grade made me quite aware that I had a very large head, and that pretty much stuck with me throughout my whole childhood through adolescence, that I had this large head on my shoulders, and for some reason it was bigger than everybody else's.
When he was 6 years old, Terry became fascinated by wrestling. His hometown of Tampa was a thriving center for the sport.
I just drove my father crazy to take me to the matches. And when he took me down to the Armory the first night in Tampa, that was it. I was hooked. I was a wrestling junkie, and I dreamed about it 24 hours a day.
Terry certainly had the right build for the sport. By the time he reached high school, he was already as big as some wrestlers.
In high school, you know, he's 6'5", 200. 50 pounds, 230, 40 pounds, plus that, so it's a big high school guy, you know, and I must have weighed all of 155 soaking wet, you know.
Terry learned wrestling moves by watching the pros, and he practiced them on other boys in the schoolyard every chance he had. But he went too far when he tested his skills on the high school gym coach during class.
He made me get down in the referee's position on all fours, and he went ahead and hooked me. And when he said go, I sat out real quick, chicken winged his arm, and I pinned him. He came up out of his mind, crazy. And I mean, I just remember running for my life around the lockers in the shower area, running from him to stay away from him.
But Terry had interests beyond sports. He was a straight A student, and one of his greatest loves was music. He taught himself guitar and bass guitar and formed a popular rock band that played local dances almost every night.
He'd come home and for breakfast he'd have maybe 10, 11 eggs, and he'd have about 3/4 pound of ground sirloin and a whole quart of orange juice. That was his breakfast.
Terry was known at school as reserved, even shy, But once in front of an audience with his band, he came alive.
When he played in the band, he was amongst four or five guys playing, but he's some, you know, the people, they always got excited about him. He was a big, so big, and playing that guitar and long blonde hair, and he's like, he always just created a lot of excitement.
Showmanship was in his genes. His mother, Ruth, had been a musician and a professional dancer.
He got his talent from his mother because she plays the organ, plays the piano, and
I used
everything.
To teach dancing.
And, I've felt that that's where he got his talent.
Well, thank you, Peter.
When he left high school, Terry hoped to make a career in music. But he also studied business management at Hillsborough Community College and the University of South Florida, just in case the music didn't work out. At one point, he even considered making a career in banking, but fate intervened, and banking's loss became wrestling's gain. While playing with his band one night, Terry suddenly found himself nose to nose with a local wrestler.
My girlfriend was in the crowd, and another wrestler paid too much attention to the young lady. I stuck my nose in between the two of them, and there was a little altercation, and that led to the wrestlers asking me to come down for a tryout. If you think you're so tough, why don't you come down? And, you know, and I went down there, and they got me in the ring, and then they broke my leg. So I learned my lesson pretty quickly about how serious they were.
Terry learned the basic wrestling moves and also how to withstand pain. His teachers wanted to see if he had what it takes. He kept coming back day after day and told everyone he'd found his calling.
Terry'd get himself all beat up, come home, throw up, and turn right around, go back the next day for more. So I say he was dedicated. Anything he did, he stuck to it.
They pretty much tortured me for a couple years with exercise and getting in shape and stretching me, which means bending your arms and legs to the point of passing out and screaming and the way they did in the old days.
Eventually, Terry's coaches decided he was ready and booked him for his professional wrestling debut. Terry Bollea was about to take his first step on the road to becoming the Hulk. He began his professional wrestling career in 1978 at the age of 25.
At 295 pounds from Tampa, Florida, Terry Mulder.
Terry didn't start out with the name Hulk Hogan. Promoters gave him names like Terry Boulder, the Super Destroyer, and Sterling Golden.
Push away by Boulder.
He'd been training for 2 years for his first match, and he was so pumped up that when promoters asked him to go easy on his much smaller opponent, he didn't listen.
Basically, he fluttered around the ring, and once I got my hands on him, it was game over. And he was screaming and squealing the whole time. Take it easy, don't kill me, don't break me in half.
And he's got his work cut out for him. Reversal, full slam by Boulder.
Terry soon learned that there was more to pro wrestling than body slams and drop kicks. Image was just as important. He was told to play the bad guy, which came as a major surprise to his two biggest supporters at home.
Tell you something, boy, I am the strongest man in the world. Anything that goof can do, I can do better. I'm going to show you right now.
I was shocked, though, because Terry's always been such a quiet person. And the first time that I saw him on TV, when he was just popping off and going all about screaming and yelling, I couldn't believe what I was hearing.
To learn this business, you need to be a bad guy, because in this business, when you're in the ring, the bad guy always leads the match. It's almost like a man leading a woman in a dance. The bad guy sets the tempo. He listens with his ears, with his heart. He gets the instinct for the crowd, what to do, what not to do, how to create emotion, bring him to the edge of the seats, really get him mad at you, and then have him cheering and screaming and crying for the hero.
Terry discovered that being on the wrestling circuit was a constant grind. He spent relentless months on the road, wrestling almost every day for a weekly check of $125. His traveling companion and tag team partner was Ed Leslie.
We started out living in the van, traveling, living, eating, sleeping. You know, we lived between the van and the arenas and the gym. And that was like our home for a while.
Takes it right back.
In the 1970s, before the spread of cable television, wrestling did not have the national exposure it enjoys today. Dozens of local promoters each had their own regional circuits, and the wrestlers were far from being the multi-millionaire superstars they are now. For the young Terry Bollea, wrestling meant long hours, hard knocks, and small checks. But he was convinced it was all worth it.
I knew someday I would catch on. I was watching what was going on. I was watching the show business aspect combined with the physicalities of this business, and I knew I could be better at it than anybody else.
Terry based his optimism on fan reaction. Even though he was playing the bad guy, he was a crowd favorite wherever he went.
The girls screamed over him and loved him, and every guy in the audience wanted to be like Hulk. They wanted to be as big as him, have the body like him, have the muscles like him, and with one punch knock somebody all the way across the ring. So he had everything it really took to be a superstar.
The promoters agreed. About 1 year after he began wrestling, Terry received an offer from New York that would launch him to national fame.
She was fired from fashion house Anne Klein to pursue her dream.
She became a hero for an awful lot of women for her strength and her desire to create a company that had her name on top of it.
Creating a fashion label that's all about the modern woman.
Women looked at this stuff and they went, oh my God, somebody knows my life.
Donna Karan in Rich and Royal. Premieres this Thursday night at 9 on Bio. Real life stories.
Attention passengers, this is your flight attendant speaking. Please switch off any audio devices.
Who makes up this stuff?
I'm going to require oxygen in 10 minutes.
Okay.
Do not be alarmed by any strange noise.
She has to drop in now.
Supposed to be there at 1 o'clock.
25 hours.
As we are expecting turbulence ahead.
We're outnumbered.
Enjoy your flight with us on Airline USA. Monday nights at 8 on the Biography Channel.
The Hulk, without a doubt, is the most awesome figure in professional wrestling today.
Terry Bollea had been wrestling for only a year or so when he caught the eye of New York's biggest promoter.
His chest expands to an incredible 59 inches. His biceps are 26 inches, and at the end of these powerful arms are two 12-inch fists.
Vince McMahon Sr., who owned the World Wrestling Federation, brought Terry to Madison Square Garden and gave him the name Hulk Hogan after the hit TV show of the time, The Incredible Hulk.
He is the Hulk.
By 1980, Hulk Hogan was a headline attraction for the WWF. That year, before 50,000 fans at New York Shea Stadium, Hulk was pitted against the reigning star of the ring, Andre the Giant, who stood more than 7 feet tall and weighed about 500 pounds. Hulk lost the match, but his appearance won him a much bigger prize. One of the millions watching him on TV that day was Sylvester Stallone, who decided he wanted Hulk for his next movie, Rocky III.
I was in the locker room, and I got a note from somebody, and it said, please call Sylvester Stallone about a large part in a Rocky movie. Yeah, right, okay. Somebody, pour beer in my bag. Okay, what's the next joke, you know?
Hulk ignored the invitation, but received the same one again a few weeks later. This time, he took it seriously and soon found himself rehearsing with Stallone in a Hollywood ring.
He came right up to my face with a camera. He goes, all right, you're a piece of crap. He had stronger language than that, but you know, you're a piece of crap and you're the worst wrestler in the world. Get mad. And I knew instantly what he wanted. He wanted to see if I could talk and do this insane promo type thing. So I said, let me tell you something, Stallone, I'll break in after you, meatball, or whatever I said. But he said, you know, okay, man, you got the part. Great.
Hockey, you better call Bob Hope.
The ultimate male versus
the ultimate meatball.
Hulk Hogan played a wrestler called Thunderlips, who battles Rocky in a charity match. Hulk was a hit with movie fans, but not with his boss, Vince McMahon Sr.
His name is Terry. You're a wrestler, not an actor. And you're not going to LA. Yes, I am, Mr. McMahon. I want to do this movie. He goes, well, if you do that, you're not going to work for me ever again.
Hogan split from the WWF and took up an offer to wrestle in Japan. Japan has a long tradition of more serious wrestling, and it had never seen anything quite like the Hulk.
Hulk Hogan, like, you know, cartoon, like a same kind of character, very strong character. And people were very excited in that time, yeah.
Antonio Inoki, an icon in Japan, helped to train Hogan in the Japanese style of wrestling with more action and fewer theatrics.
In Japan, the wrestling is much different than it is here. They want to see you guys get it on.
In one bout, the Hulk took his training a little too seriously and put Inoki, his opponent that night, into the hospital.
I wake up in an emergency car. So at that time, it's a big news. Every sports paper and front page.
After becoming a wrestling star in Japan, Hulk returned to wrestle in America and signed with a promoter in Minnesota. This time, Hulk was cast as the good guy, battling a local villain, a wrestler named Jesse Ventura.
I am the hottest thing in professional wrestling. I am the baddest dude that walks the streets today, Chump Hogan. And you think about that, Chump.
And when I came in, all the fans wanted to see me beat Jesse up.
Because you could not beat me. You could not even beat Sylvester Stallone in the movie Rocky III. It was a draw. I'd have squashed that peanut in 30 seconds.
So it was pretty easy to make that transition and be the good guy, because the fans just cheered me. Even if I cheated and poked Jesse in the eyes, the fans would cheer me for doing it. They hated Jesse so much.
But now it's up to Hulk Hogan.
By the early 1980s, Hulk Hogan's career was on the fast track. As a headline wrestler in two countries, he had little time to think about his private life. But that soon changed when he walked into a Los Angeles disco and met Linda Claridge.
All of a sudden, in walks this big, gorgeous blonde guy and all this little trailing of women all around him. And I thought, oh my God, that's the guy from the Rocky movie, you know? And I thought, I'll just go up and just say hi, because I had just seen his movie.
She thought I was an actor. She had no idea that I was really a wrestler and actually did this for a living.
For their first date, Terry made quite an impression by inviting Linda to come and watch him wrestle.
You know, I was in there thinking, so proud of him, he looked great, and the match began, and it turned into a bloodbath, basically. And I saw him fly out the ropes, and the people, I looked at the audience, you know, to see what they were doing, because he was bleeding profusely, and everybody in the audience was like, yeah, more, more. And I thought, this is crazy, you know, what am I getting into?
Terry convinced her that it was just a business, and after 2 years of courtship, they were married in December 1983. The wedding marked a double celebration, because at the same time, Hulk was getting the next big break in his career. Vince McMahon Jr. had taken over the reins of the World Wrestling Federation from his father. Vince Jr. decided that Hulk Hogan was the potential superstar he needed to transform his business from a regional outfit to a major global attraction.
I think Vince McMahon Jr. looked at the product of wrestling and said, this is a huge rock concert. Here we have these great performers, larger than life people, just like rock acts. It became McMahon and Hogan. It was just this machine of personality and business that just chug-a-lugged and made this whole thing explode.
Vince's father had fired Hulk Hogan from the WWF, but Vince Jr. could hardly wait to welcome him back. In early 1984, amid massive publicity, he pitted Hulk in a title match against a character called the Iron Sheik from Iran. Memories of the Iranian hostage crisis were still fresh. And when Hulk won the title, it set off a wave of patriotism and a new cult called Hulkamania.
Coming out with the United States flag and the USA shirt to Eye of the Tiger, you know, it was like, bam, 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 you know. And I was like, all right, yeah, I like it.
Everybody was like, oh, I hope Hogan really kicks this guy's butt. Yeah, the people were very into the whole USA, USA chant back then. And Hogan was defending our country.
Interest in wrestling exploded with Hulk Hogan as its poster boy. He was on magazine covers, talk shows, and advertising. And there were enough items of Hulkamania merchandise to fill a room in his house. Hats, t-shirts, fast food, vitamins, kids' games, dolls, even pinball machines.
Hulkamania was so big, it was on everything. It was on postcards, it was on action figures, you know, billboard signs. It even took me over where I even had all his faces put on my jackets and that I wore to the ring while I was managing him. Yeah, it still fits pretty good, too.
Hulkamania was particularly directed at kids. His constant advice to them was to train hard, eat their vitamins, and say their prayers. To many kids, Hulk was their ultimate symbol of good triumphing over evil.
The character was completely planned to exploit the wholesome image of America, and it was an unbelievable message to give to the youth of today. It's much better than the message they're getting, you know, when they watch TV and the wrestlers go, we got two words for you, suck it. You know, it's a much better message. The message was wholesome. It was the right thing to do. It was the right thing to say.
With Hulk Hogan leading the way, wrestling emerged from the show business shadows to become one of the biggest sellers in family entertainment.
Here is the count. One, two, three. It's all over. Hulk Hogan has done it.
When Hulkamania exploded in the mid-1980s, it made Hulk Hogan a new kind of wrestling star. There'd been flashy, charismatic wrestlers before, but what set Hulk apart was his crossover appeal.
This is a guy who, if the president saw him, the president of the United States would know who this wrestler is. That never really happened before.
The guys over at my country club one day said, geez, could you bring Hulk over for a couple of cocktails and a little speech? And Hulk came over that night and absolutely fascinated this group of gentlemen, the boys' club, if you will. And he was received warmly, and they just absolutely loved him and said, bring him back. Let's get him to play golf. Well, if you let him play golf, he'd take out the whole tee box.
The public had long made fun of wrestling as a fake sport. But Hogan and McMahon gave it new credibility by admitting straight out that it was organized family entertainment.
Hogan was already telling people that, hey, what I do is prearranged. It went from that fan who liked, I want to watch my wrestling, to the fan where, boy, I'm really being entertained by this. This isn't really a sport. This is entertainment. I really like it this way.
As well as families, Hogan's matches attracted some of the biggest names in show business.
You used to have them people in the front row with no D go, not in the cam! Then all of a sudden you're seeing, you know, Natalie Cole sitting in the front, you know, Liberace coming to the matches. I mean, please, I mean, from anyone, superstars here and there coming to see it, and Hulk Hogan changed it all.
Hulkamania coincided with the explosion of cable television, giving wrestlers national exposure instead of the localized fame they'd enjoyed before. Ratings and revenue soared, and Hogan's annual income in the 80s was reported to be $10 million. Wrestling fame gave Hulk Hogan a chance to chase another of his dreams, movie stardom. Ever since Rocky III in 1981, he'd had the movie bug. And in the late 80s, he starred in a string of adventure and comedy films, including No Holds Barred, Suburban Commando, and Mr. Nanny. He loved making films, but had no illusions about his acting credentials.
I never pictured myself as a movie star, you know, simply because I can look in the mirror and be very honest with myself, and that's not Brad Pitt staring at you across the mirror or Sean Connery, but I had an opportunity. I said, well, maybe there is a niche for me somewhere.
Film critics were unimpressed. Roger Ebert said in one review, "It makes me feel tired of going to the movies." But because of Hogan's crossover appeal, most of the films turned a profit. By the early 90s, acting had become a lot more attractive to Hulk Hogan than slugging it out in the ring, especially when Vince McMahon began promoting younger wrestlers at the Hulk's expense.
I don't know if he was pushed aside, but I do know that there were plans to not utilize him, possibly as that superhero main eventer.
Hogan quit the WWF in 1994. He'd been wrestling professionally for more than 15 years, and the physical and emotional pressures had taken their toll. He was happy to leave the ring behind him.
Having to pull it off, having that pressure of having to be better than everybody else and just carry this torch that was just had an unbelievable weight, that the timing was, I was tired, I was hurt, my attitude wasn't that very positive, I was always complaining about my aches and pains.
They're always injured, always. They take trash cans to the head, tables over the head, steel chairs over the head, and they literally take those bumps.
As Hulk Hogan, he'd had to wrestle up to 400 times a year. But now he had a young family. His daughter Brooke was born in 1989, and his son Nicholas in 1990. The break from the ring gave him more time to be Terry Bollea, a husband and father.
He gets up in the morning with the kids, and he'll either pour him some cereal, or we take the kids out on the boat. He's just very, very much at home and just relaxed. He's a teddy bear. He's really just the big mellow giant, you know? He's not really like that on TV, although he has got a tender heart and he's a very good person. He's just really laid back.
Hulk Hogan's public persona is bigger than life, etc. But when he's home, he's a very warm person. A lot of his critics say that this guy has such an ego and he's such a phony, et cetera, et cetera. They don't know the Hogan who I know.
In 1994, Hulk Hogan began working full-time on a TV adventure series, Thunder in Paradise, filmed in Orlando. But as much as he enjoyed the acting life, wrestling still had him in a headlock.
Let's get ready to rumble!
On the same studio lot, Ted Turner's World Championship Wrestling was being filmed, and Hogan just couldn't ignore it.
And so finally, because it was in my blood, I started talking with some of the wrestlers and going by and visiting them.
Before long, Hogan worked out a deal with Ted Turner that allowed him to wrestle and to continue acting on television. He'd found a perfect balance in his career, and the announcement of his return to the ring was widely celebrated by fans. But a bombshell was about to hit, one that threatened to end his career altogether. In 1994, Hulk Hogan was preparing to launch a multi-level career with Ted Turner's TV networks.
When the going gets tough, the tough get rough. Hey, oh, come on.
Under the deal, he would return to wrestling and continue conventional acting in TV dramas. He'd also have the time to indulge in another longtime interest, music, with his own records and videos.
But the ink on his contract with Turner was barely dry when Hogan found himself making unwanted headlines. His former boss, World Wrestling Federation owner Vince McMahon Jr., was charged with illegally supplying muscle-building steroids to his wrestlers. The FBI ordered Hogan to appear in court as its chief witness.
The government needed one person that had enough clout, basically because it was me, had enough visibility that I would be like a bolt of thunder coming from God, that everybody would listen when I talked.
Hogan had always claimed in public that he'd never used steroids, but under oath, he admitted that like many professional sportsmen, he had taken them earlier in his career, before they were outlawed. Hogan testified, however, that McMahon had not supplied him. McMahon was acquitted, but Hogan's admission damaged his own reputation.
Oh, it ruined me. It ruined me. The whole message of training, saying your prayers, eating your vitamins, this all-American hero, which was this character, which was the right thing to tell the kids, all of a sudden, the American public felt betrayed. The first thing that happened was I had a vitamin company out there, a children's vitamins, that basically went out of business because of it.
It was pretty devastating to Hulk because all of a sudden he was kind of singled out. You know, you did steroids, you were the one that did steroids, holy moly. And it was like he was carrying the whole wrestling world on his back.
Hulk Hogan responded by doing what he knew best. Just 3 days after testifying, he made his ring debut for Ted Turner's World Championship Wrestling, winning a title match against Ric Flair.
Well, you know something, Mean Gene. Hulkamania is running more powerful than it's ever been.
Despite the continuing steroid controversy, or even because of it, Hulk Hogan was again the wrestler that fans wanted to watch. WCW's ratings soared, making it the number one wrestling show. That set off a bitter ratings battle between the WCW and Hogan's former employer, the WWF, that continues today. But by the mid-90s, the Hulk was past 40 years of age and had been playing the American hero for more than a decade. There were signs that the public was not buying the image as eagerly as before.
One night after we came back to the back, Hulk goes, you know, did you hear the boos that I heard? And I said, yeah, I did. And he goes, you know what? It might be time for a change.
As the ratings started to drop, WCW executives suggested that the Hulk should make a daring change of image from hero to villain.
Well, I've been a bad guy before, but now, you know, I'm etched in stone as the all-American good guy. That'd be tough. The fans, I don't know how they could handle it.
Leading villains Kevin Nash and Scott Hall. And under the new name Hollywood Hogan, he announced...
And I mean, they were wigged. They couldn't believe that this really happened. A soda pop, and actually it hit me in the nose. And while I was conducting this interview, there was a little trickle of blood going down my nose. And I said, Hulk, you did this to me.
You fans can stick it, brother!
Turned against all the fans and told them how I used everybody and I didn't care about anybody anymore. A whole new interest was started. The wrestling fans were going, oh my God, what's this maniac going to do next, you know?
The fans that grew up with Hulk, all of a sudden, you know, they had their little Hulkamania dolls that they were bringing to the matches and burning them and throwing them down now because they had grown up with Hulk, and all of a sudden now this guy turned on them, and so it was fantastic.
Hollywood Hogan!
As a bad guy, it's more fun to just see how crazy you can make these people. It's much more easy to punch people's buttons on the aggressive level than it is on the happiness level.
That I didn't think he was capable of doing or saying. I didn't think he was that mean.
I couldn't go along with that bad guy stuff. But anyway, it seemed to be all in the ball game, and I just overlooked it.
I did get after him for that, though. I said, Terry, I know this is all part of the show, but do you realize you got two little kids at home, and these kids all look up to you, your little fans and everything. say your prayers, take your vitamins, respect your parents. I said, and now you're acting like this? I said, how do you think it's going to affect him?
Hulk Hogan had always been proud of being a role model for kids. He defended his actions by saying he was still a role model, except that now he was showing kids what not to do.
I definitely want them to know that when you're a bad guy and you take shortcuts, you're going to fall short of your goals. Hollywood Hogan cannot win a match, and if I do, I cheat. If I get by 1 week by the skin of my teeth, the good guy sure makes up for it the next week. And as a good guy, I was a world champion for 10 years, and as a bad guy, I can't hang on to that darn belt to save my life.
Hogan became the wrestler the fans love to hate, and once again, the rating soared. In fact, as the anti-heroes, the Hulk and his fellow villains became more popular than
or that they would cheer for me. So much that it became a big political dilemma behind the scenes. The good guy wrestlers were being like a bunch of crybabies to the promoters. These guys are so cool, they don't like us anymore.
Hulk played his bad guy image to the hilt, including the time he terrorized an unsuspecting Mel Gibson. The actor had just lost a friendly wager of $50 to Hulk's wrestling buddy, Brian Knobbs.
Mel goes, well, okay, you know, I get the $50 right here. And Hulk Hogan became up behind him and grabbed him by the shoulder and said, $50? Knobbs just said, you owe him 50 grand. You bet him 50 grand on the fight. I thought Mel Gibson had just shocked himself. He went, oh, what? I didn't bet $50. It was $50. Hey, but. And then we laughed about it. It was just, you know, good fun and joke. I mean, Mel appreciated it afterwards, you know. We kind of got Mel Gibson. And I did get that $50, by the way. I did. Thank you, Hulk. So you got that $50 from Mel Gibson. If not, you know, we would have broke him in half.
Hogan's close connections with celebrities have always been a major source of his appeal. In the 1980s, he attracted them to wrestling arenas. In the 1990s, with a close eye on the ratings, he took things a step further, persuading some unlikely stars to get in the ring with him. Through the 1990s, Hulk Hogan was always looking for a gimmick to boost his ratings. First, he switched from hero to villain, and the ratings went through the roof. To keep up the momentum, he persuaded a string of celebrities to wrestle with and against him on primetime. He teamed with the self-proclaimed bad boy of basketball, Dennis Rodman, for several matches against another basketball player, Karl Malone, and wrestler Diamond Dallas Page.
And here comes Page! And there goes Rodman!
The bad guys usually lost. An even more unlikely celebrity opponent was Tonight Show host Jay Leno. After a pre-planned argument on the show, Hogan and Leno vowed to settle things in the ring. Although Leno appeared to be heavily outgunned physically, his team managed to triumph over Hogan and his fellow villain. After all, this is show business. By 1999, Hulk Hogan had been playing the bad guy for 3 years. And like all gimmicks, this one wore itself out. Fans now prefer to cheer for a new, younger generation fit, and again donned his hero's costume of red and yellow.
Everything revolves around money and ratings, and so we did a big thing where Hulk kind of switched from a bad guy to a good guy, and right off the bat, people loved him. Off and running again. Bam!
Playing the good guy again fit in more easily with Hogan's work behind the scenes. Children have always made up the majority of his fan base. And to give something back, Hogan has put in untold hours for kids' charities. The Make-A-Wish Foundation has honored him for being the most requested celebrity by their kids over the past decade.
These Make-A-Wish kids are so special because when they come, you see so much happiness in their face no matter what the situation is. And they're so happy to see Hulk Hogan or Mickey Mouse or whoever they're coming to see that they actually give the celebrities energy too. And I mean, if I don't feel like even bending over and lacing my boots after I see these kids, it's, hey man, let's go do it, you know, because they give so much back.
And he just didn't go, hey, I'll give you an autograph and leave. You know, he'd spend time and he goes, here, let me get some of that power in my arms from yours. And he'd rub the little kid's arms or put his arms around him and really talk to him and spend some quality time with him, even though he had a match coming up, you know.
Oh, my God.
Hulk Hogan has announced his retirement several times, only to make a comeback. But the injuries are building up. He has recurring neck and shoulder problems from having been driven headfirst into the floor a few years ago. And in 1999, he had major knee surgery, but he is loath to call it quits.
I'm probably in the best shape of my life. You know, if I had a couple wishes, I'd wish for a full head of hair and a new knee. The guys are moving a lot quicker, and they're much more aggressive in the ring, and I'm going to turn the dial up and definitely keep up with them. That's not a problem. I just don't know how long the knee will last, so stay tuned for part two, Hulk Hogan on a wooden leg. Can I get him up? Oh, well. All after a hard day's work. Where's my beer and the slippers?
We have to go back. You get the clearances.
Of course, no sports star can go on forever. And like all good businessmen, Hulk Hogan has been laying the groundwork for a post-wrestling career, probably in entertainment. He still has his eye on Hollywood, hoping for the chance to body slam the movie industry, as he puts it.
Retrieving JJ and nailing Fraker, that's the bottom line.
Maybe I'm at the age and I've got the sins of mankind written on my face with a few wrinkles that I could fit into that leading role as a good guy or the leading villain here that might go after a Sean Connery, or maybe Arnold Schwarzenegger will meet his match in Hollywood, Hulk Hogan. You never know.
When he began in the late 70s, wrestling was a fractured regional industry. Now, it's one of the biggest money earners on television.
Hulk really, by his appearance, his look, his ability, and everything else, really kind of put wrestling on the map and made people watch it and come out of the closet to see it. So in a roundabout way, all the merchandise that we sell now and everything else and the TV sponsorships was really Hulk Hogan doing that.
Three, it's all over!
He just puts out more energy. A switch gets turned, bang, and then that energy starts just blasting out, you know, like lightning bolts. I don't know, it just spreads. And it just seems to spread to the people throughout the arena or wherever he is.
Wrestling will never replace Hulk Hogan. There is only one Hulk Hogan. There can be Bill Goldberg's, there can be Stone Cold Steve Austin's, there were Jimmy Superfly Snuka's and Bruno Sammartino's, but there is only one Hulk Hogan, and everybody knows who he is. He is the man.
He understood this business inside and out. He understood what you needed to do in the ring, how you could play on the emotions of people. And he knew what you had to do outside of the ring to be a big success. He is the biggest star that this sport has ever seen. And I don't see in my lifetime anybody coming down the pike like him.
Why hasn't he burned out years ago as an attraction? Why hasn't Batman ever left people's minds? Why hasn't Superman left people's minds? He's a bigger than life character. If it wasn't for Hulk Hogan, I don't know if wrestling would be around at this point, because I don't know if the fan interest would have held it.
I quit.